Right, the slides are in, you know, you can scan this QR code here to join this WeChat group, and then we will send you the PPT slides, PowerPoint slides for this next presentation. We put it on 石墨.im, which is a Chinese site that's like Google Doc.
Maybe you can try and discuss
with your neighbor. 那你就可以尝试着和坐在你旁边的其他人来一起分享一下吧。 Right, and later I'm going to speak Chinese, speak Mandarin. My English is not so good.
Oh, thank you. Okay, so, 对对对。
And this lady, she speaks very good English, but I don't. So, please allow me to speak Mandarin. Well, we are still a little bit ahead of time, but let's just kick off. Today, the topic is the open source community development in Greater China area. When I submitted this, the slides, it was all in English, but now it's translated into Chinese already. So we can see that there are like around 10 guests here that are not from China. So I believe what you may find interesting is about the development of the open source community in Chinese mainland. But I'm personally from Taiwan, across the sea from mainland, but I'm now working with Huawei based in Shanghai. So I actually participated in the open source communities of both sides, Chinese mainland and Taiwan. There might have been some cultural shock and different opinions and so on, and these are the things I want to share with you in this presentation, so that the Chinese mainland community of open source can better understand the Taiwan open source community. And also, I also invited some of the LinuxCon's lecturers, speakers this year to Taiwan, so to the biggest open source conference in Taiwan. I invited 10 of them from different organizations and invited them to Taiwan. So we're all in the Greater China region, so we have now forked into two branches, and most of our codes are the same, but we still have differences. Hopefully we can look at each other's data codes more so that we can better understand each other. Okay, now let's kick off. I'm Richard Lin Yun-Chen, currently I work at Huawei and I'm a developer ecosystem manager. My job is about developing the developers or the users. I'm now promoting this Model Arts, which is this logo here, which is an AI development platform. It has nothing to do with my topic here today, so this is the end of the commercial. Okay, about this one, Open Foundry, what is it? I used to work with the Central Institute of Taiwan, which is just like Chinese Academy of Sciences in Chinese mainland. So at that time, the Taiwan government invested some money so that people could use the funding on developing the open source community, do the incubation. So I was with the Open Foundry. I was doing research on open source at that time. So downstairs, you can see there is the open source Kaiyuanshe, which has an exhibition booth down there. So it's a community I started in Chinese mainland with some people. So it's like open source community. Yeah, literally, that's a Chinese word. And also, I worked with the Shanghai Linux user group, and I was an organizer in that. So I have been working in open source for over 10 years, and I did some presentations. We ran out of power, right? Okay, so like OSCON and also there was this conference in US. My company sent me to speak there, and also the Chinese open source conference, COSCUP, and conference on COSCUP, which is an open source conference in Taiwan and also Hong Kong open source conference and so on. I did attend those conferences. I mean, for Greater China region or the Mandarin speaking, Chinese speaking region, I have some communication with different parts of this big region. So for those people who just arrived, as I just said at the beginning, you can join the WeChat group by scanning this QR code and grab a copy of the slides. Hello, if you want to get the slides, scan this QR code and join our group. I'm also from Taiwan. I started working with the open source community about 5 years ago, first with Kai Yuanshi, and then with an internet community in Taiwan. So we want that community use technologies to improve the society, and also there were other open source communities from Taiwan. So today my topic in this presentation is about the practice in the open source community, about what we have been doing, and of course we want to learn more from Chinese mainland. Next slide. Okay, I have my microphone on my Amino. So okay, my topic is about Greater China region's open source community development, but most of you are already in this community, and downstairs we have the exhibition, and you can see that in China region, the open source community has been developing. But you may not know much about the Taiwan's open source community, and for those friends from other countries, if you want to find out more about Chinese mainland's open source community, I'm sorry that I will not talk about it much, but of course you can always talk to me after the conference, after the presentation, and talk to other friends here to find out more about Chinese mainland's open source community. So here is my topic, grassroots open source community. They have to grow and grow their roots deeper, and this is a voluntary community. I can see a difference between Chinese mainland and Taiwan in terms of the open source communities. Let me move on. You know this map. This is the Greater China region, including Chinese mainland, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and Macau. I was born in Taiwan. When I was 30, I came to mainland to work and participated in the open source community. I had a big cultural shock, and my wife is from Shanghai, and she had a big cultural shock from Taiwan, from me as well. So I was quite impressed, even though geographically we are so close. Just as I said, we had the same source code, and now we forked into two branches, and it's going to take some time to merge into one. So let's look at each other's codes. Okay, we are the same in terms of the social progress, the free and open source software. The free open source software. If you look at these words here, opening up and reform. Okay, when we talk about opening up and reform, you think about 1979 in Chinese mainland and Deng Xiaoping. But actually, when I was a child, Taiwan also had the opening up and reform. The president, Jiang Jingguo of Taiwan, opened up the economy and so did some reform. So for my parents' generation, it was like earlier, the economy had been pretty isolated. So when I was young, Taiwan was richer than mainland because Taiwan opened up earlier than mainland, not because Taiwan was stronger or anything. I mean, when I was a child, my father, in 1980, my father could earn like 7,000 to 8,000 Chinese yuan per month. And for Chinese mainlander at that time, they earned like 700 or so per month. That was a huge gap. Taiwan opened up and reformed a little bit earlier, so it got richer a little bit earlier, and then became a moderately well-off society, and then open source community became good as well. And this second line, second bullet point is, Taiping Chen Huiying is a South China son. I was surprised that when I was in Chinese mainland in 2014, this song was still played. It says, if you fight, you win. So Chinese mainlanders believe that if you fight, you win. you succeed. So, however, for Taiwan, the economy has long plateaued. They reached the ceiling. So, Taiwan couldn't really grow the economy much further. So, whether you win or you lose has been decided by your birth or by your parents. So, I believe in the next two or three decades, the same will happen in Chinese mainland. Like in Shanghai, some people, they have quite a few apartments, right? They worth tens of millions. So if you come to this city as a newcomer, no matter how hard you work, you don't win. You don't win over them. And also, next, about the open source, like Thomas, they started as students. So I mean, students are important for the open source community. When I was young, I had to really handle very stressful tasks for my study and for my job. And that was when I was young in Taiwan. But now, in Chinese mainland, there is even more stress because there are so many people in China. Now, parents have to go through interviews to send their children to kindergartens. And also, the kindergartens do background checks about how long the parents, the family have been living here and so on. I mean, they select the children starting in kindergarten. There has been competition starting at the kindergarten level. Like in Taiwan, such competition and differentiation only starts in high school. So here in China, people are trained this way that they have to study so hard, work so hard. However, for open source community, it requires a lot of interest. And also, the university entrance exam is not a big challenge in Taiwan. And also, some people, like even if they don't go to university, like they still succeed. My friend started this community. He only graduated from junior middle school and started this community, and now he is a lecturer in Jinan University in Taiwan. That's because in open source he worked for so long and he loved education, and also Taiwan has the policy so that even people without very high diploma, they can still join a university as a lecturer. But in Chinese mainland, you have to really study and get that. And next is about division of work. In Chinese mainland, it's very top-down. That is to say, everybody wants to look upward and climb up the ladder. But in Taiwan, it's different. Like, the grassroots level can also help change the society. And the last one is Maslow's hierarchy of needs theory. So in Taiwan, people are getting close to pursuing their ego, but in Chinese mainland, people are still thinking about making money so much because their job, their life is so stressful. So I think I took up too much time, right? Already 10 minutes. Okay, let me move on. You need to think about your identity. I have to. Okay, sorry to the interpreters, but I have to head faster. So,
I believe that the communities are connected. So no matter where you work, you have different identities. You might be working in education sector, and also you might be involved with the government or the companies. So sometimes you have double identities, and the community can connect people. Let me tell you a story. So what make it possible for this one? This is Niao Ge. And he lives in Taiwan, and he started his website. And he has been playing with Linux, and he takes many notes, and then he built a website for his notes. And after he has been doing that, you know, he has a lot of interactions from people, and then he turned it into a book. So sometimes people can read his things online, but the publishers insisted to publish his book, and eventually he was published, and he's a contributor in the open source community. So he did not make a lot of money with this book, but he has contributed a lot in the community with this action. So in Taiwan, actually, we have many hardware companies. And for GPL violation, then people are concerned with it. And in Taiwan, there is one company that has been sued. in GPL violation. And there's an open source foundry, and which is called OSSF. And this has been led by the government. And in mainland, there is a COSCUP. So in Taiwan, we have also got a criticism for OSSF. So we didn't see that kind of a criticism in other places. So in scientific research, we need to have an open source release. In 2013, it does not have a GitHub. So for OSSF, did the Open Foundry. And then this has worked with many scientific programs. So Taiwan Jiao University has started courses in FOSS and CS. And also, as we mentioned, we have the Open Club Association, which is actually a student association in Taiwan. And in the middle school, there's the EasyGo, which is the software center. And in the civil society, we have a SLAT, that is Software Liberty Association in Taiwan. And also, we have Open Culture Foundation and the Wiki. So as for this kind of civil organizations, actually, Taiwan has a lot of sponsor for that. So let me show you something here. This is the fourth community in Taiwan. So as you can see, these are the communities like OS development and the DevOps, etc. So if you click here, there are thousands, there are hundreds of communities. So Taiwan has a population of only about 3 million, but for each community, we have like about 10 people. So this is a photo that I have taken in the Linux user group. So first, there's a mailing list. Maybe you think that a mailing list is easy, but for Chinese open source, mailing list is not effective because for mainland people, they do not use a mailing list. So Shanghai is no exception. So for mainland China, they use WeChat groups or Telegram groups. So if they use a Telegram, there are more entry barriers. So it's not that easy for you to get involved in it. And also, there are other kind of online sources. For offline, why did I highlight it? Well, actually, for Hacking Thursday, actually, this is an event in Taiwan. So this was started by a guy from Taiwan, and then he organized it in Shanghai at Jing'an Temple. And this is an event which happens every Thursday. Moreover, there is a monthly meeting. So the photo you have seen on the right is the Hacking Thursday in Shanghai. So welcome to join us. And I occasionally join it because I have been so busy in Huawei. So for COSCUP, actually, I've been involved with it in Taiwan for many years. So for many of you, it's new, but you know that in Taiwan, there are hundreds of communities. So some has 10 or 20 or 50 people, but with this COSCUP, then this is an annual meeting of the different communities in open source. So this is the conference for open source coders, users, and promoters. So the contributors include coders, users, and promoters. So we have been talking about coders in mainland China, but sometimes people forget users, but it gets useless if you do not have users or promoters or fans. So That's why it's really nice. And you have free registers, and there's no entry barriers. And actually, you can get sponsors from companies or from individuals. And moreover, you have a peer review in it, and there are some cross-border community collaboration at COSCUP. Well, in Taiwan, there is a SITCON, that is Student IT Conference. That means the students like open sources, and they are from COSCUP. They are volunteers. There are about 200 volunteers every year, and then they organize this kind of conferences spontaneously. And students are the organizers, and they would invite those teachers who make a lot of contribution in it. So the students can invite the teachers to join the conference. In the mainland, usually it's the teacher who organizes conference, like CCF. But in Taiwan, this one is the opposite. As for this concept, actually, it has been popular in Taiwan and has been borrowed in Hong Kong. And in Hong Kong, there is SITCON Hong Kong. And in mainland, it has a SOSCON, which is a student open source conference in mainland China. So this kind of culture of a bottom up is really important. So, as for the conference, that were big events, but in Taiwan, there are also smaller ones, like the Shanghai Hacking Tuesday, that's the Hacking Thursday, which is smaller. And also the Mozilla space actually has a sponsored space which can host about 20 to 30 people to talk about open source. And then you can actually apply for this space if it is about open source events. And you can apply online. And actually, the management of the space is also done by volunteers. And actually, the cleaning of the space is also managed by the volunteers. So if you are free, you can just jump by this space, and that might be something interesting. So this is mostly about hardware open source. So in Shanghai, and there are also similar organizations. And in Shenzhen, there are also similar programs. As Richard mentioned, Taiwan has the open source community culture. So people are gathered based on the same hobbies. And for this kind of culture, this is really influencing Taiwan. And actually, as for open source, actually in the past, you were waiting for people to teach you, but with open source, everyone is a collaborator, and everyone can actually contribute to the community without waiting to be called to make a contribution. So people have been talking about kernel and kernel-native and the deployment. But we were talking about G0V, or we call it Gov0. So actually, this is a community based on internet, and this is a non-profit community. And we believe that we can bring some benefits to the society. And the mission is don't ask why nobody does it. Actually, first, you need to know that you are nobody. And nobody is capable of doing everything on himself or herself. Therefore, we promote this concept. And the QR code you can see here, this is the WeChat group for this presentation. So I believe there are a lot of things that we can do together for the community. Actually, it's not based on any language or on any technology. So actually, we have been involved with many things, like whether your work hours is in violation of the laws, or we also help people to measure the plant conditions. And also, we help people with their household stuff. So this organization helps in art, education, and agriculture, non-profit, and journalism, and disaster prevention, etc. So there are a lot of things that we launch in this community. A lot of things has been added. So many languages has also been added, and also some local dialects have been added in this platform.
所以这边就是算自干吧，就是因为都是你需要你想要做的事情。So
these are the things that we want to do.
那个程序员他想要种菜。So
the programmer wants to plant some vegetables. So actually, they are all in GitHub, and all of that are open source. So actually, for open source, this is really inclusive. So as for our community, we do a lot of things about households. For example, if you are working to help different industries, we need coders, but we also need other skill sets. So here are the skill stickers, which shows the skills that people have in this community. And every 2 months, we have a hackathon, which can host about 100 people. And people argue, what can you do if you organize a conference for 1 day in every 2 months? Well, the fact is that it has been running for 1 year or 2 years. And for hackathon, actually, you meet people from different industries. And you might meet people who are in iOS or in app development, and you can start collaboration with them in this platform. Next, I want to talk about a tool and how we have promoted the open project. So we believe everything is equal, and actually it is decentralized. So in the hackathon proposal, we use the hack folder, and you can actually send the proposal and the GitHub connection, and whether it's MIT or other authorization. And then in the hack folder, then you can list the different connections here.
Okay,
so when we have an annual conference for 1,000 people, we use the same promoters, the same proposals. And everything that can be published is published online. And for example, the information about the venue and the finance are very transparent. So we also use hack folder for earthquake in Taiwan. So when there was an earthquake, actually, we integrate all the resources online, like all the news online.
And there are like 20 or 30 people online at the same time, so they can do it in 10 minutes. And it can be connected to our existing interface, like which hospitals still have beds, and also the reports from the residents are put into a map. And next, I want to talk about the open source community in Chinese mainland. Well, I know these things, but I always think I want to tell the open source people in mainland that in Taiwan, the open source community has been doing things for many years. However, they are not known in Chinese mainland. So it happened to me that several members here are from the Taiwan show. So I want to say that this is a platform for all of you to join in so that we can connect these open source people and then they can do something together. It's not like what's been done in Taiwan because it's been like that for over 10 years. For example, Apache Roadshow in 2015 is by Apache Foundation for the first time in China, and we as Taiwan Shi worked with them, collaborated with them. So at that time, we thought lots of the Apache projects were introduced to China. I mean, it was not so formal, but it's sort of like we became a partner of Apache, and also we have the open source annual conference in China. In the past, other organizations had done similar things, organized similar events, but we selected the topics and that were sort of different, and we were less commercial, and we had different opinions. We want to let the open source people to decide everything, and also we talked to universities, and also like the hacker competition and so on. Last year, we made this China annual report of open source. So we use CSDN and also Linux to send out questionnaires. So today, if you happen to pass by Kai Yuanshe's booth, please fill out our questionnaire so that we can make the 2019 annual report of China open source. Later, I'm going to send the link to our WeChat group, which you just joined in. So if you have time, please help us by filling out the questionnaire. I, as one person, cannot do much, and our core team only has like 10 to 20 members, but I want more people to join the Kai Yuanshe. I work in Huawei, some other members work in other companies, but please, let's all spend some time, a little time. Don't just push others to do things. Nobody is omnipotent or anything. We just want to invite people to join this organization so together we can do things. That's the important thing. I'm not trying to advertise for Kai Yuanshe, but I think you may have ideas and you don't have to join this organization. You can also start your own organization or something so that China will become a more fertile land for open source community. And we still need to spend a couple of minutes to wrap up this session, right? Would you? Okay. About the open source code, we know the community is more than the code. When people only look at the open source code, they only look at the achievements of the people. They don't want to contribute, they only want to use others' code, others' achievements. In the past years, China really took lots of things from everywhere. But now, gradually, China's attitude is changing, the sentiment is changing. China now wants to contribute to. If you read the Bible, I mean, in China, maybe not many people read it, but it's a better fortune to give than to take. So in the past, China left everything, so it took many things from all over the world, but now China is becoming richer, so it should do something, it should give, it should contribute more, so that we will have a more positive cycle. So together, we can fertilize this land of open source. We often say this is a fertile land, and that is a fertile land, but that means that we contribute to make it fertile. So let's roll up our sleeves and work hard. That's what the Chinese leader said. So talk is cheap. So we don't, well, I think I'm just reminded that I still have 5 minutes, right? So let's keep those 5 minutes for Q&A. That's what I have to say for presentation. So any questions? This one, please.
Well,
you know, in Chinese mainland, people work like, you know, 996. Have you heard about 996? They work 9 to 9, 6 days a week, and then this traffic jam, they get home at 11, and then the next morning they go back to work. So how can they have time to work, to do anything for open source community? What's your suggestion? Oh, very good question. So my suggestion is, you can always spare some time. Indeed, this is a harsh environment. I actually visited Europe and America, and I visited Facebook and Google and so on. The world is not equal, but even though it's not equal, we still need to make progress. I mean, they started earlier than China, so they are now doing better. So while we still have to do a difficult job here in China, still, we should contribute to the open source community. And if you are able to do it, it means that you are very competent. If you are very competent, or if you have high competence and high expectation, you can do it. So it's the strong people who do these things, right? Let me add something, a follow-up question about 996. 96 days a week. So I think many organizations, they stay in the office until 9 p.m. because the boss is still in the office, so they feel reluctant to leave early. So they're just sitting there like idling around without going home. However, if you sit there in the office but being unproductive, then spend that time quietly, silently, spend that time, that evening time in the office on open source. Yeah, you don't have to let your boss know. I mean, it's not much time, it's not easy. And you don't have to work on open source. You can also do something to maintain your health. Like, sometimes people say that they work 996 and they become unhealthy. But don't say that. Don't blame your boss. Don't blame your company. Don't say that another company is like, another company is good and yours is bad, or open source is hard or anything. Let's just work on the difficulties and find out our opportunities to do more for open source and otherwise. And I hope we don't have to work 996 in future. Okay, thank you. Well, I want to add something. Some people say that open source is very demanding, that I have to participate in big projects, I have to like write a lot of codes or anything. But actually, you can do very small things, make a small tool, or like there are some research work you cannot do on your job, so you want to do it outside your job. I mean, it's not that very high requirement. You can take those very small steps, baby steps, and still make progress in the open source community. Yeah, thank you. And here's one question, and then next is that one. Okay, my follow-up question. I think you had great experience. You have been working on open source community, and meanwhile, you work at Huawei. So I want to ask you, how is Huawei doing? Like, how are they promoting open source? Because I think doing a job in Huawei is very stressful. Huawei is a very demanding employer, right? So your job is already busy and stressful, and then how do you work on the open source community? And also, how is the open source work helping your job? And how do people share the resources and win together in open source community? Well, it's not just in Huawei. I mean, any Chinese company I worked with had only two possibilities to do the open source contribution. One is that your company sends you to do contribution, to make contribution to the open source. And also, otherwise, it's your personal hobby and interest. So Apache Carbon Data is the first open source project in China. So it's the first Apache project by a Chinese team. So Huawei think it's important. That's why they sent people to work on it. And those people who were sent to do it are now my boss. So I understand their ideas. And they did complete their job and they became open source experts. To find out more about Apache, they learned a lot. And gradually, they learned it was fun. And then they made friends, they worked with lots of Indian friends and work on it together. Now they really enjoy open source, even though they may have the different initial impression about open source. They did it for their job, I started for my hobby, but we both worked on open source community in China and we are both contributing, so there's no conflict, no matter it's your job or your hobby. Hi. About the open source community, the individual contributors and corporate contributors are both important, right? Yeah. Like in China, we can see that more and more companies are paying attention to open source now. But now the phenomenon is that some companies use the open source as a KPI, key performance indicators. So they first do some projects on open source, and then afterwards they don't pay attention and it went sour. So when you look at the open source communities in Taiwan and in other countries and regions, according to your knowledge, is that something that has to happen in open source? Or is it just because China is still underdeveloped in terms of open source? Well, in China, in Chinese mainland, this is a special phenomenon. So even if you go to like Dianping, a consumer review website, they still try to fake the ratings, but then they may fake the rating in GitHub as well, right? So they have to exceed the KPI, so they try to do things to achieve the KPI, even by not very good, not very healthy methods. But ultimately, we have to ask the fundamental question, is the such work, is such action contributing to the industry or to the sector? So no, they're not thinking about this question hard enough. Like, no matter how hard you fake the consumer rating on a restaurant review website or app, ultimately the business depends on how good the food is. So if you look at how many projects are open, but how many of them are fork and so on, I mean, it depends on how you design, you as a company design your KPI and how you operate your KPI. If you really do it well, then it's a successful project. And this is more senior, Kevin. Kevin helped me a lot, like Open Vision Network. So if you want to get some patent protection for open source and so on, you can talk to him. I mean, he's really senior, like my guru. Hello, I want to ask you about the open source and free software and open source software. How do you think of them? Well, I started my journey by looking for free software on the internet. I mean, I had to look for key, you know, on the internet, you know what I'm talking about. And then I thought it was not so good. I mean, since I was a child, I was educated about IP protection. So Taiwan was blacklisted on 301 of United States, so was sanctioned. So I knew piracy was bad. So I started to look for non-pirated free software, but sometimes there were bad things wrapped in it. Right then, I thought maybe open source software didn't have that issue, so I looked for them. So I wonder, why were they so silly, making free software, not charging the users? And then I got started. And second, about the free software and open source software, I read Thomas and Richard and read their works, and then I understood it better. I mean, when I was raised the Taiwan's Central Institute, I read those books and understood more. I think we are over time, are we? Yeah, already. So we can still talk to each other afterwards, right? We are in that WeChat group already, and I will be outside, and please feel free to talk.